for everything. And you can't keep trying to grow fruit in the wrong season. It's never going to be good. And some of us have had relationships that have been past their season. Keep on going here. If you can see this, God sometimes removes people from your life to protect you. Yes. Don't run after them. Now here God has gotten rid of your invader. And you're like, man, where they go? And you're going running after them. And then bring them back. You can't, you're not gonna, they're going to come back with all their friends. If God removes folk, because he's protecting you from something. He's protecting, even folk, you're allergic to invaders. At some point, God's protecting us. And we're going to run after what God has already removed. God knows who belongs in your life and who doesn't.
Yes, he does. Yes, he
trust
does. Yes, he does.
And let go. Whoever is meant to be will still be there. Mm-hmm. When it's all said and done, you got to have some folk in your life to get your back. Any back is short, but you got some in your pocket. Yes. But when you don't have anything but limp, are you still there? At this point, God will show you who's supposed to be in there. And we have let too many people into our inner circle who did not prove trustworthy to be there. And then folk who did prove trustworthy, we got mad and put them out. But sometimes God blesses us by removing things from our life. His deletion could be for our protection. So that's the first. So we have to remove. Here's the next one here. Rejoice. This is the next hour we're going to have. Rejoice. We're going to spend more time talking about this in a little bit. Rejoice. Rejoice comes from the Greek word kalos. And it has several meanings. We're only going to talk about one and pick up the other ones on Tuesday. Rejoice. Two times it says in those few verses, rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. Most of the time we've heard the word rejoice, we thought it always meant to be up. And it always meant to be kind of, you know, you ask somebody, you see somebody at the grocery store, how you doing today? Praise the Lord, I'm doing fine. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. My toe fell off, praise the Lord. Now that's not rejoicing all, just going back and praise the Lord all the time. No. Rejoice comes, let me give you a couple of definitions here. Rejoice in the Lord always. Now, so if rejoicing in the Lord always, you can't be, you're not going to feel like talking about praise the Lord all the time. Rejoice in the Lord always. So it's got to be something deeper than that. Now here's the point. If you can read this with me, read this for over here. This is the day the Lord has made. We're going to do what? Rejoice and be glad. See, I didn't know what today was going to be. But I'm going to rejoice today. I appreciated it yesterday. Oh, glory. It was good. Yes, it was, honey. It was good. But the idea was, I'm going to rejoice today. And on tomorrow, I'm going to rejoice on that day. Now, thank God for today. Praise God. But I'm going to rejoice on that day. This is the day, today, the Lord has made. And I'm going to rejoice today and be glad in. I'm not going to spend my time worrying today and jack up today about something probably not going to happen tomorrow. I'm going to rejoice today. I'm going to be glad today. I'm going to praise God today. I'm going to honor God today. I'm going to lift up his name today. I'm going to celebrate today. I'm going to be today. I'm going to be thankful for today. Now here's one. Now so what does rejoice mean then? Here's what the first thing rejoice means is to be well. I love that. It means to be well. So be well all the time. And again I say be well. Be well, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. Be well in the Lord always. And again I say be well. What does be well mean? It means completeness, wholeness, and thoroughness. That we are complete in him always. And again I say we're complete. We are thorough in him always. And again I say we're thorough. We are whole in him always. And again I say we're whole. So this be well means to be then have completeness, wholeness, and thoroughness. Please read this with me right here. We know from Colossians, what does it say? In Christ, we have been made complete. Let me give you one more. Then I gave this one, then we'll pick up another one on Tuesday. Here's the next one. So not only does rejoice mean to be well, what's the next one? It does what? Exhale. In other words, it's another way of saying be extraordinary. That believer excel always in the Lord. And again, I say excel. Don't give up. Don't turn around. Don't be average. Be ordinary, extraordinary in the Lord. And again, I say be ordinary, extraordinary. Now, I love this. Please, if you can't read this, please listen to this. This is so beautiful. God did not create any of us to be average. Mm-hmm. So, repeat after me on that one. God did not
create me
to be average. All right, let me read the next part, then I have you repeat after me after I read. He didn't make us to barely get by. Okay, now your turn. He didn't make me to barely get by. Oh, I just felt something right there. Let's do it again. He didn't make me
to barely get by.
Now we can say it together. We were created to excel. We were created to excel. We were created to win. We were created to walk in triumph. We were created to walk in overflow. We were created to be restored. We were created to excel. Excel in the Lord always. And again, I say excel. I'm telling you, at some point, we got to start recognizing that there's some transformational power in us through the power of the Lord. And as a result of that, that transformation ought to come to people around us. Just the other day, this Friday, Thursday, as a matter of fact, we had this conversation. I've been working with a student who has had an F all year in math. Working with her a couple times, I mean, I was like, you know, it got frustrated along the way. I'm just saying right now. And so Pastor Dill come in, like, I don't know how you do it. I'm like, I don't know if I want to keep doing it. But I was there, they didn't work with her. Came back and got her exam for the year after having F's all year long. Finishing the year strong with a B and all of them almost that close to an A. What am I saying? That God says, I called you not only to excel for yourself, allow that transformation to occur around people. Everybody has some people in our lives right now who are living at the F level.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
And we got enough transformational power in us. Dear brothers and sisters, here's our point. They're at an F, and then we can start, because they're in an F, we start walking in the F and get fleshy. And we step out of our transformation. I know you didn't say it to me. As a result of that, we go down to their level instead of raising them up to where God would have them to be. When I'm offering this point that God created us to excel, and not only just us, but our organization, our church, our family, our club, our sorority, our fraternity, we're supposed to be excelling because of who God is. You out there, out, you can be the only believer in your office. Got to excel. There's enough transformational power in you to make sure you excel. Let me give one other point right here. So excel simply means right here being prosperous, promoted, and propelled. You've got to be propelled to greatness, glory. You've got to prosper like you never thought before. Even at this point, you've got to be promoted to a whole different level. Then it's about being excelling, to be able to do what God has called and created us to do in me as well. So this idea, so now read this with you with the top part of this again. Today. When?
Today.
When?
Today.
When?
Today.
I don't care how bad it was, how good it was, how horrible it was, today I'm going to rejoice. And when this day is over, it's gone. But tomorrow I'm going to say the same thing. Today I'm going to enjoy this day. And if this is the day the Lord has made, I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. Let me go back in here. The opposite, verse 25. You know that one. It says, restore the years the locusts have eaten. That's the R right there. So but let me give you this E right here. I'll give you one E and we'll finish up for this time. No, let me give you this one E. I love this part. It says, eat in plenty and be satisfied. Verse 26. I want you to be clear about what's happening here. God is speaking to the people, and as they're looking around, all they're seeing is this: desert, parched, arid. And God says, No, I've restored. So you're going to be able then at this point to eat in plenty and be satisfied. What are we saying? God has made promises to us that we haven't always seen the manifestation right now. Mm-hmm. We have to believe his promise for provision more than we believe the problem. Mm-hmm. I said we have to believe his promise for provision more than we believe the problem. We see the problem, but my problem has already been solved by the God of my provision. I got to remember the promises God made. So that I can remember the promises God made for my provision, I can overcome the problem. But if I only focus on, now, so right now, so we look at this. Some people look up here and all they see is all the stuff that's not working out. Some people look and see right there in the middle of all that, nothing working out, there's some growth that's occurring. What God is saying at this point, I need you to focus on not your problem, but focus on me, the provider of your provision. Yeah. I gave you a promise of my provision. Focus on my promises. Stop talking about your problem. I need you to talk about my promises because I've already provided what I told you I'm providing. Stop talking about your problem. I need you to stop looking at all of the desert and look at the deliverance already right there.
Yes.
How could it be in the midst of all this desert there's still growth occurring? Go through East Greensboro right now. It's amazing. You see one house, the mother's house right next to it still standing. God said at this point, I need you to know that I'm a God then. So in the midst of all that goes on, you will always, God says, eat in plenty and be satisfied. Here's what we have. So basically we're talking about abundance right here. Abundance. That's what we're talking about, abundance. Now, you may not be able to read this, but I love what it says here. God's abundance far exceeds our expectations. Mm-hmm. Listen to that. God's abundance far exceeds our expectations. Whatever our expectation was, God's abundance has exceeded. Please write down Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that can ask or think according to the power that works within us.
Yes.
So now, please read this with me right here. God desires to overflow you with his abundance. If you believe it, can you just join me in giving God a hand clap of praise? God desires to overflow you with his abundance. So there ought to be abundance, it says right here within me. There ought to be abundance around me. And it says there ought to be abundance throughout me. There ought to be something that we leave here recognizing God has provided abundance. Now let's talk about this other part here. This is the last part I want to deal with. It says, eat in plenty and be satisfied. Eat in plenty and be satisfied. Last thing we're going to talk about right here, this is where believers in many cases have some challenges. We're just not satisfied. Some point, we got to learn to be satisfied with our portion. Mm-hmm. Flour. At some point, we got to learn to be satisfied with our portion. As long as I'm hating on you because you got more, never going to be restored. As long as I'm comparing myself to you by what you have and I don't have, never going to be restored. I got to recognize that I have learned to be satisfied in God. Now, here's the last one I want you to see right here. I love this one here. Read this with me, please. This is just, we'll end with this one. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. Beautiful. Read that again. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. One more time. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. When we become satisfied in him, that's when God gets glory. When I recognize at this point, for years, people have sung songs and they have nice beats in it. You remember that song years ago, Silver and Gold, Silver and Gold? I'd rather have Jesus than Silver and Gold. Folk is lying. Now, at some point, I got to recognize, I'm going to go back in here, I got to be satisfied. You mean to take, even though, if I'm satisfied and completed him, that's when God gets glory. As long as I feel like I need God in, that's a problem. But if I can need God in addition to it. But when I recognize that everything we need is in Jesus. I'll end with this as we get ready to go about this being satisfied. I shared with you before that, and then at this point y'all saw that Reverend Harrison was gone for a while. She gone on another cruise. She came back all tanned. And so the story is told again about this family. They saved up all year long to go on a cruise. They had never been on a cruise before, never left out of little village before. Saved up, just saved everything to it. And they got everything they had, so they brought some crackers on board the cruise ship. And while they were there with the crackers on the cruise ship, they didn't have any money to eat because all their money went to purchase the ticket. And so they had just a few pennies left, and they told them, little boy said, I'm just so hungry, I don't want any more crackers, I'm just going to get something. They said, so they gave them all the rest of the money they had, they gave it to a little boy. He comes back over there and has an ice cream cone with three scoops on it. And he's just licking, wearing it out. Mom and dad are starving. He's wearing the ice cream cone out. And he's already eaten something. They said, how did you go out here? We only gave you this much money. How did you come back and eat a full meal and also have 3 scoops?